Good morning and thank you for joining me today. We are right in the middle of Lent and it's such a wonderful season of diminishing our lives and magnifying Christ in our lives. That's our theme, let Christ be magnified. And boy, I couldn't enjoy it more. I think it's a very powerful time and a very important time to set aside ourselves and some of the things, whether they're pleasures or whatever we have before the Lord, and say, you know, instead of that indulgence, I'm going to set my heart on having Christ expand in my life and in my heart. Boy, nowhere is it stronger than at the communion table. And I think in Jesus's life, this is a very pinnacle time on earth. And he was really at the point of truly denying himself and taking, sacrificing himself for his friends. And in this, at this table, and when he instituted it, it was a very, very poignant point and a very special time with his friends, a very human, loving time and a very God time. So I love that part. And we know in Philippians, he really, it says that he humbled himself even to the point of death on the cross. And that's the example we are to follow. But doesn't that seem crazy? You know, that we fall in love with God, we fall in love with the life he gives us, yet he asks us to surrender that life to him so that others can be changed by it. And the scripture I chose today is Philippians. It's the first chapter of Philippians. It's about Paul. And Paul always is a wonderful figure for me in that he is, you can see his growth through the epistles. And he's been so tenacious on holding on to the truths of God. He has more relaxed about how it all happened. He doesn't ever move from the truth that we are not by performance, but he does let God, he sees God moving in every circumstance. Where I'm going to share today is in Philippians 1:16. The former preached Christ from selfish ambition. This is 1:16, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my chains, but the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. He's saying that people have been preaching Christ their own selfish ambition. They've poured it on him and picked on him. But he comes to this point, he says, what then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and in this I rejoice. Yes, I will rejoice. Wow, what a great attitude. He knows God is able to use every circumstance to bring his truth and his love forward to bear on people's lives. He goes on to talk about, for I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed. He believes God will always be his reputation. But with all boldness, he returns to faith here as always. So now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. He comes back to that he's a pure instrument of God. He surrenders his will. He is tenacious on the truth, always speaking it. But God is the Lord of his circumstances. And he believes if he holds on to Christ, if he keeps his faith, then in every situation, God will be magnified through his life. What a wonderful statement. And what a wonderful parallel to Christ's life, that the lower Christ went, the more power that came out of him, that he surrendered and humbled himself even to the point of death. Here, Paul is making that same bold but humble statement that God will be magnified no matter what. What a great thing. So whatever circumstances you're in this morning or today, if you will humble yourself, hold on to your faith and hold on to the love and trust you have in Christ, I believe he will find a way to magnify his truth and his love through your life. And don't give up on that. It's our life. In every ordinary circumstance and every high watermark and every low watermark, we hold on to him and he uses our lives to reach out to those around us. So, well, let's celebrate this table and let's bring these thoughts into reality as we receive the Lord himself. So we know in scripture, and certainly 1 Corinthians 11, it says, on the night he was betrayed, what a powerful statement, that he was going to be set alone and be deserted. He took the bread, which is actually himself. He is the bread of life. He broke it, signifying that our lives would be broken too, but be blessed. He gave thanks. Father, we give thanks for your son, Jesus. He is the bread of life. He's who we live from and sustains us. And we know his love for us will hold on to us and give us direction and open up our path in front. Despite circumstances, despite situations, you are the great bread of our life. We receive you. Give thanks for you. Whatever elements you have, let's take and receive. Thank you, Jesus, that your life was broken, that ours won't be destroyed. That in the breaking of your life and in the surrendering, humbling of our life, we are healed. We receive you. In the same manner, same posture, same great faith, great love, he took the cup. Said, this is the cup of the blood of the new covenant. And as you receive it, as often as you drink it, you do so in remembrance of me. Thank you. Thank you for your blood, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood that courses through our veins, that ties us to you, the heavenly family. And as we receive it, we receive forgiveness, we receive life, we receive healing, we receive power. Bless your name this morning. Well, I pray you have strength today, and as you receive this table, you move forward in faith, in great love, and also hope. Thanks for joining me this morning. Happy Lent.